Thanks to everyone from MAMA for having me here again. It's been a pleasure to be back, and hopefully I can come back to kind of the unofficial Jan van Eyck dépendance in Croatia. My paper tonight is part of a longer work on Benjamin and Brecht, and especially a bit kind of a side project of what I did in my book on the Messianic and Benjamin. Like, the Messianic and Benjamin, normally people would say, is the early, more metaphysical, theological Benjamin, and then the later Benjamin of this famous text on the concept of history. So what I'm dealing with is the ultra-materialist Benjamin, the Benjamin of the early 1930s, just after he started his close collaboration with Bertolt Brecht. So this is also the period where when Benjamin was first received abroad, especially in the English language. That was the essay, of course, that most people know, the work of art in the age of mechanical reproduction, or what's the new title closer to the German of technological reproducibility. That was 35-36. Then the other one is 34, The Author as Producer, also a very famous text, also for the English reception of Benjamin. So I will just read out this paper, and if there are things to be clarified, you can also interrupt me. It's called A Positive Concept of Barbarism, Benjamin and the Consequences, and of course there are a lot of consequences. So in 1930, Walter Benjamin wrote, "Thought should become impoverished. It should only be permitted insofar as it is socially realizable." And 3 years later, he gives a further twist to this provocation and adds, "With this tremendous development of technology, a completely new poverty has descended on mankind. And the reverse side of this poverty is the oppressive wealth of ideas that has been spread among people, or rather has swamped them entirely." End of quote. In this paper, I will revisit Benjamin's diagnosis of a modern poverty of experience, Erfahrungsarmut, and its corresponding plea for an impoverishment of thought. If in the age of capitalist realism, to quote Mark Fisher, capitalism seamlessly occupies the horizon of the thinkable, we have to supplement Kant's famous three questions. What can I know? What ought I to do? What may I hope? With another one, what is imaginable? If psychoanalysis and post-Kantian epistemology agree that our experience and of objective reality is fundamentally structured by fantasies and our subjective faculty of imagination, how can the impoverished reality of everyday life be experienced? What are the capitalist realist conditions of possibility of experience and imagination? If Benjamin's thesis also applies to our age, how are we to dismantle the reverse side of the poverty of experience, the plethora of ideological doxa, that is, the, as Benjamin put it, oppressive wealth of privately owned opinions which occupy and block the space for radical thought? Drawing on Benjamin's writings from the early 1930s, I'm particularly interested in politico-nihilist operations of impoverishment, destruction, and reduction. As is well known, Benjamin's post-Socratic battle against doxa is not driven by a conservative contempt for popular culture, but on the contrary, aims at a new post-humanist concept of technology in the age of technological reproducibility. His concept of second technology, or zweite Technik, opens up a Spielraum, a field of action beyond the horizon of capitalist domination and instrumental means and ends relationships between physis and anthropos. This emancipating technology, however, is not envisioned in humanist utopian manner. Rather, in ultra-modernist fashion, it radicalizes the experience of capitalist alienation and impoverishment. Against the pseudo-messianic fantasies of capitalist progress, perfectibility, and sustainability, for Benjamin's peculiar kind of Marxism, the technological medium of the post-humanist constellation of nature and humankind cannot be constructed by virtue of a communist acceleration of the productive forces of capitalism. As we shall see, His paradoxical strategy of an accelerationist decelerationism exceeds the horizon of bourgeois liberal humanism. Calling for an impoverishment of thought in the age of capitalist impoverishment is neither progressive nor regressive. Rather, it aims at a lightning-fast pulling of the emergency brake of the racing train of capitalist modernity. The Benjaminian figure who is able to perform such paradoxical task is the modern barbarian, the one who inhabits and survives the impoverished space of capitalist realism without supplementing poor reality with the wealth of bourgeois humanism. Now I'm coming to my first section, that's on the barbarian. Historically, the barbarian was defined as a foreigner, one whose language and customs differ from the ones of the speaker. In ancient times, people of such kind were called non-Greeks or later non-Romans. For instance, the tribes of the north, which challenged and eventually overthrew the rule of the Imperium Romanum, were called barbarians. Departing from this meaning, the modern noun barbarism is broadly used as an antonym to culture and civilization. A barbarian is thus someone who is at odds with humanist culture and civic virtues, such as civility, fairness, literacy, politeness, and judgment. Of course, if you think of barbarism these days, you probably have watched that video already. Yesterday it was shared a million times, I guess. It is it was shared yesterday from the channel of that ISIS is using the onslaught in the Museum for Antiquity in Mosul, so where in pseudo monotheist fashion some pagan idols were destroyed. Today I learned actually that most of these things, the statues were replicas, so replicas made for exhibition, not the original parts. Nevertheless, the people who were engaged in that were quite busy with destroying these false representation. Maybe they even believed more in art than the people who exhibited them. Nevertheless, this is what in common to common knowledge would be called barbarians. They are against culture. So against this common sense understanding, in the mid-1940s, Horkheimer and Adorno suggested a different concept of barbarism. Drawing on Homer's Iliad, their materialist critique of ideology associated the barbaric way of ancient life with a quote, state in which no systematic agriculture and therefore no systematic time managing organization of work and society has yet been achieved. Lacking the Christian concept of history and the modern economy of time implemented by the capitalist division of labor, barbaric temporality is structured by the myths, governed by mythical laws of fate. However, already in antiquity, the overturning of myths bears traces to the Age of Enlightenment and the latter's dialectical reversal into mythic times and barbarism. With the liberal bourgeois and later totalitarian failure of the project of civilization, myth and enlightenment, barbarism and culture reveal their inherent convertibility, contradicting the humanist belief in infinite progress of human history. In light of fascism, anti-Semitism in Auschwitz, the dialectics of enlightenment finally collapse, short-circuiting myth and enlightenment, and quote Adorno Horkheimer, culminating objectively in madness, a madness of political reality. If enlightenment is not only, quote, mythical fear radicalized, but totalitarian itself, myth is already enlightenment, and enlightenment reverts to mythology. In short, for Horkheimer and Adorno, a non-dialectical opposition of barbarism and civilization, myth and enlightenment cannot be upheld anymore. As we shall see, Benjamin, who in many ways can be regarded as critical theory's predecessor and critic, arrived at a similar understanding only a couple of years before. However, his dialectic concept of the modern barbarian suggests a different reading of the reversal of culture and barbarism and the implosion of the concept of humanist progress. Long before the rise of totalitarianism in early 1915, while imprisoned, Rosa Luxemburg wrote her famous Junius pamphlet, you can see here, which was published in 1916 at the height of World War I. Allegedly, quoting Friedrich Engels, Luxembourg presents a famous alternative. In a quote, bourgeois society stands at the crossroads, either transition to socialism or regression into barbarism. In its socialist afterlife, Luxembourg's alternative between socialism and barbarism was translated into the teleological perspective of either progression or regression. But what if Luxembourg's either-or option had already been decided by capitalist world history, yet in a different way? The triumph of imperialism, as she concludes, leads to the annihilation of civilization. However, while conceding that in the current war, that is World War I, imperialism has won, Luxembourg still based her communist wager on the prospective final victory of the class-conscious proletariat. In 1933, when Walter Benjamin wrote his short essay Experience and Poverty, Luxembourg's Marxist wager was not feasible anymore. Imperialism had won the Great War, and fascism was ready to prepare the next one. Benjamin's perspective of defeat, however, is not defeatist. His question is simple. What is the impoverished horizon of possibility once the world historical question of socialism or barbarism has been decided in favor of the latter? What could be a communist strategy in a world of capitalist and or fascist barbarism? Is there a positive meaning of the figure of the modern barbarian as a mode of mimetic survival, as someone who is capable of dialectically surpassing capitalism's own homegrown barbarism? If bourgeois culture and Western civilization have not only become, but are inherently barbaric, barbarism cannot be attacked from the position of bourgeois culture or the vulgar Marxist belief in progress. As Benjamin will later write in the seventh thesis on the concept of history from 1940, I quote, this is the famous one, there is no document of culture which is not at the same time a document of barbarism. And just as such a document is never free of barbarism, so barbarism taints the manner in which it was transmitted from one hand to another. The historical materialist therefore dissociates himself from this process of transmission, Überlieferung, basically tradition, as far as possible. He regards it as his task to brush history against the grain. End of quote. Barbarism and culture are not to be conceived as external oppositions. If there is no document of culture free of barbarism, we may also state the reversal. There is no document of barbarism that is not at the same time a document of culture. For Benjamin, therefore, the dialectical tension of Luxembourg's wager has not been annulled. Rather, its terrain had been shifted, displaced to the realm of barbarism itself. Now, in post-cultural capitalism, and with the rise of a new fascism, the figure of the barbarian reveals fully its dialectical nature, allowing for paradoxical positions such as barbaric salvage, regressive progression, and anti-utopian utopia. And the rest of the paper is basically a meditation on what these kind of antithetical concepts could mean. Second part, experience and poverty. In Experience and Poverty, Benjamin notes that, quote, with the tremendous development of technology, a completely new poverty has descended on mankind. And this poverty is not merely poverty on the personal level, but poverty of human experiences in general. Menschheitserfahrung, as he writes. Human experiences are not measured quantitatively, but qualitatively. They are communicable experiences which can be told, shared in storytelling. In his later essay on the storyteller, from 36, Benjamin cited a central passage from his earlier essay to unfold his central argument, according to which our ability to exchange experiences has declined in modernity. If, quote, experience, Erfahrung, in this, might add, in German, you have two words for Erfahrung, Erlebnis and Erfahrung. So the English translation, of course, constantly struggles with only having one word, experience. So you always have to give in brackets what is the one. So here we have Erfahrung. So if Erfahrung, which is passed on from mouth to mouth, is the source from which all storytellers have drawn, modernity can cannot tell stories in the way the old storytellers did. Nevertheless, Benjamin's modernist question is, can we think of a new medium, a coming tradition in which we can embed individual experiences, Erfahrungen, and share them collectively with a linguistic community beyond functional socialization? If tradition is the ability to transmit collective experiences in a meaningful way, modernity is not simply without tradition. Rather, modernity invented the notion of tradition in the first place. However, the mode of the production of meaning has changed in modernity. If in capitalist modernity, all that is sordid melts into air, all that is holy is profaned, as Marx and Engels famously claimed, the modern experience is also a liquidated one. In his 1939 essay on Baudelaire, Benjamin argues, and Baudelaire, of course, the key figure of the concept of what modernity is. So in his essay on Baudelaire, Benjamin argues that in capitalist modernity, Erfahrungen, so impartable experiences, have been replaced by immediate shock experiences, Erlebnisse. Relying on Freud, he detects a shock defense mechanism with which the psychic apparatus shields itself from the penetrating power of the shock Erlebnis. This defense mechanism, however, is not only of negative nature. Experiences, Erlebnisse, are precise raw data of lived moments deprived of their impartible meaning, communicable meaning, that what you can share in storytelling. Experiences as Erlebnisse are always assigned to an individual subject at a certain exact point in time, even if they have been experienced as a collective. Their trans-individual historical signature is not anymore derived from the continuous transmittability of tradition, but induced by fragmented shock experiences and socio-psychic interruptions, the collective medium of which Benjamin theorized in technological terms. In the second version of his essay on the work of art in the age of technological reproducibility, by the way, that has been translated a couple of years ago. Some of you might know there. This famous essay has three versions. What we are used to read is the third version. It's also in the Suhrkamp Edition. Then we have a first version, a draft version, basically. We also find in the Gesammelte Schriften of Benjamin. And then there is a second version that was always lost. Later was found after Horkheimer's desk, actually. On his desk, always they looked in all the archives, but as a purloined letter, it was always on top. So they found it, and they have published it in 89, and thanks to the English editors, it has also now been translated. It's a very interesting one. It's the one where Benjamin has a completely different, not a completely different, but a different understanding of technology. So I'm quoting from this one. And there he gives some hints of how this new technological medium of perception and experience, here understood as Erfahrung, could be conceived. He mentions a second technology, a zweite Technik, a liberating and emancipatory technology, the goal of which is not anymore mastery over nature, like in capitalist exploitative first technology, but a collective interplay, a Spielraum between nature and humanity. Already in his aphorism book, One Way Street, published in 28, he warned that, quote, man can be in ecstatic contact with the cosmos only communally. It is the dangerous error of modern man to regard this experience as unimportant and avoidable, and to consign it to the individual as the poetic rapture of starry nights. The task of the post-humanist human is thus to construct a new technological medium for communal experiences, Erfahrungen, which exceed the scope of individually fragmented Erlebnisse. However, against the ideological trends of late 19th century Lebensphilosophy and the vitalist, quote, attempts to grasp true experience, true Erfahrung, as opposed to the kind that manifests itself in the standardized, denatured life of the civilized masses, Benjamin assigned the realm of modernist experiences, Erfahrung, to an eminently profane sphere, end of quote. Erfahrung is the outcome of work, Erlebnis is the phantasmagoria of the idler. Without the constructive work of experience, there are only short-lived Erlebnisse. However, the collective construction of a new technological medium of Erfahrung cannot rely on the Erfahrungen of the past. It has to start from scratch, from the world of fragmented Erlebnisse, a world of experiential emptiness, which Benjamin calls Erfahrungsarmut, the poverty of experience. The figure who has mimetically adjusted its life to this world of experiential poverty is the new barbarian, the one who has to start from the beginning. In the literary tradition of the early 1930s, the term barbarism was not solely reserved for fascism. And indeed, Benjamin was not the only writer who claimed the term in a non-pejorative way. In December 1932, exactly 1 year before Benjamin published Experience in Poverty, the American pulp fiction author Robert E. Howard had invented the fictional character Conan the Barbarian, which was infamously adapted for cinema in 1982 by the same titled movie, kickstarting the career of Arnold Schwarzenegger, as we know. In Howard's original fantasy story, The Phoenix on the Sword, Conan is a prehistorical mythic warrior who engages in various battles in the fictional kingdom of Aquilonia. Notably, Conan is depicted as an anti-idealist, natural killer, devoid of all virtues and vices of civilization and its cynical sophistry. And a quote from Howard, from the Phoenix on the Sword. What do I know of cultured ways, the guilt, the craft, and the lie? I, who was born in a naked land and bred in the open sky. The subtle tongue, the sophist guile, they fail when the broadsword sing. Rush in and die, dogs. I was a man before I was a king. As a political observer of his time, however, Howard's oeuvre is not limited to Conan and pulp fiction. In a letter to H.P. Lovecraft from December 1935, Howard wrote, and I quote to Lovecraft, "Your friend Mussolini is a striking modern-day example. In that speech of his I heard translated, he spoke feelingly of the expansion of civilization. From time to time he has announced, the sword and civilization go hand in hand. Wherever the Italian flag waves, it will be a symbol of civilization. Africa must be brought into civilization. It is not, of course, because of any selfish motif that he has invaded a helpless country, bombing, burning, and gassing both combatants and non-combatants by the thousands." This is Ethiopia at the time. "Oh no. According to his own assertions, it is all in the interests of art, culture, and progress, just as the German warlords were determined to confer the advantages of Teutonic Kultur to a benighted world by fire and lead and steel. Civilized nations never have selfish motifs for butchering, raping, and looting. Only horrid barbarians have those." End of quote. Implementing the violent rationale of humanism, that is, just ends of civilization can be met by barbaric means, bourgeois and fascist anti-communisms rely on a similar logic, presenting the barbarian as domestic civilization's externalized other. However, Howard's revaluation of the term barbarian does not only question the non-dialectical opposition of the concepts of Kultur and civilization on the one hand, and barbarism on the other. It is not only that there is no document of culture, which is not at the same time a document of barbarism, as Benjamin wrote 2 years later. Rather, the concept of barbarism itself allows for a transvaluation, a Umwertung of the term, revealing its critical potential against the self-declared saviors of Western civilization, namely fascism. Of course, in parenthesis, you know, war on terror, the axis of good versus the axis of evil. We have lots of kind of historical sampling of this kind of rhetoric, the West against barbarism. Taking aside Howard's otherwise naive fantasy of barbarism as a primordial, honest way of living prior to corrupting civilization, the structure of barbaric reduction also plays a key role in Benjamin's certainly different take on the barbarian. As we shall see, Benjamin characterizes the barbarian as an anti-ideological simplifier of life who can meet humanity's basic needs rather than endlessly complicating them from the standpoint of bourgeois reason and its fictitious causalities. Benjamin's new positive concept of barbarism announces a new life form, neither derived from a nostalgic past nor a prophetic future, but from the poor now and the, quote, dirty diapers of the present. In accordance with the Brechtian maxim, quote, don't start from the good old things, but from the bad new ones, the new barbarian articulates a post-humanist experience of impoverishment, proletarianization, and capitalist privation that liberal bourgeois humanism can no longer account for. We can, of course, call it today precarious life. Radicalizing the decline of a pre-modern, meaningful cultural universe, Benjamin understands that the basic elements of a new form of experiential importability, Erfahrung, which is true to the challenges of the age of the machine, technological reproducibility, and capitalist commodification, can only be found once the status quo of an imposed material experiential impoverishment is acknowledged in forthright terms. As is well known, in the aftermath of the stock market crash of October 29th in 1929, the last year of the Weimar Republic were marked by a severe economic downturn. In the early 1930s, poverty was most of all economic poverty. Starting from its economic meaning, Benjamin puts forth a broader concept of poverty, conceiving of it in its economic, cultural, and phenomenological scope. Poverty in the age of the capitalist mode of technological reproducibility does not only affect our perception and modes of experiences, but reduces the human being to its basic needs. The economico-existential impoverishment through capitalist relations of production imposes a negative simplification, a radization, you can say, or a root, radix, extraction, to which radical thought has to respond. Of course, we can say this radix, root extraction, in capitalist terms, is nothing else than what in Marxian terms would be the extraction of abstract labor, of labor force. This is the, let's call it, the negative simplification in capitalism, which at the same time lays the foundation of the social bond, the social relation in capitalism as the relation of value. So in preparation of his radio talk on Bertolt Brecht, broadcasted on Frankfurter Rundfunk in June 1930, Benjamin wrote a programmatic note foreshadowing the figure of the modern barbarian and introducing a leitmotif of his debates with Brecht in the years to come. And I quote, thought should become impoverished. It should only be permitted insofar as it is socially realizable. Brecht says, at least once people no longer need to think on their own, they are unable to think on their own anymore. But to attain an effective, wirksome social thought, people must give up their false and complicating wealth, namely the wealth of private assessments, standpoints, worldviews, in short, the wealth of opinions. Here we are touching upon exactly the same struggle against opinion in the interest of truth, against doxa, in which Socrates engaged 2,000 years ago. The effectiveness of social thought is not measured by the logic of the marketplace and the cost-effective ratio of capital investment. It is not improvement, progression, and accumulation, but impoverishment, reduction, and dismantlement that makes social thought more effective. If, as Marx has it, the wealth of societies in which the capitalist mode of production prevails appears as an immense collection of commodities, end of quote, poverty is the appearance of thought which is rich in social results. Quote Benjamin, and in fact, rich in results, folgenreich, so rich in consequences, we might also say, with regard to both life and thought itself. But how are we to understand this antithetical conjunction of wealth and poverty? Benjamin's fierce criticism of the liberal bourgeois idea of democracy, namely the wealth of privately owned opinions that compete in a pluralistic way, touches the core of his take on Brecht. In the final version of his radio talk on Brecht, he said, and I quote, this is again 1930, Anyone who wants to define the crucial features of Brecht in a few words could do worse than confine himself to the comment that Brecht's subject is poverty. How the thinker must make do with the few applicable ideas that exist, the writer with the few valid formulations we have, the statesman with a small amount of intelligence and energy man possesses. This is the theme of his work. End of quote. Reading Brecht with Benjamin, a theory of poverty has to impoverish itself. Thinking has to reduce itself to shrink its width and depth to meet poor reality. Yet this economization of thought does not follow a capitalist logic. Poverty is not a raw material, a stable state, or a given situation, but a reductive procedure without final goal. There is no zero level of poverty, just different degrees and layers of impoverishment. If poverty is both the heteronormous condition of capitalist exploitation and the privation of human experiences in general, poverty cannot be conceived of in rich terms. You might also say in philosophical terms, in philosophically rich terms. The task is not to celebrate or idealize poverty. Rather, thought has to turn itself into the medium of poverty in order to liberate itself from the oppressive plethora of complicating opinions. This destructive or cathartic side of thinking poorly has constructive dimensions. In his talk, The Author as Producer, 4 years later, 35, Benjamin defines, quote, "The most urgent task of the present-day writer as that of recognizing how poor he is and how poor he has to be in order to begin again from the beginning." Of course, we know Benjamin himself was also very poor at this time. He was already a refugee. He was living off funds of his friends while traveling Europe. Also Bertolt Brecht, by the way, who helped him. Yet within the realm of thought, this beginning from the beginning first necessitates the gesture of tabula rasa, a clearing away of the complicating wealth of opinions which stand in the way of new beginnings. That is to say, the tabula rasa, the clean board, never exists as such and can never be reached. The political board is always written and overwritten. There is no zero level of written doxa, but only the movement of clearing away. Instead of supplementing poor reality with the bourgeois wealth of opinions and false options, in a truly Socratic way, thought has to take side with truth, with the truth of a society in which social poverty and private wealth coincide. In other words, truth is made of doxa itself. Truth is self-reflexive doxa, an opinion the position of which has been changed, denaturalized, and estranged. Verfremdet, in Brechtian words, und umfunktioniert. In this new position, form and content of doxa have been short-circuited, annulling its meaningful content and rendering it dysfunctional for its sophistic appropriation and revalorization. For Benjamin, the act of thinking and the realm of the thinkable are generically collective. Once thought becomes privatized, sold in a sophistic way, and accumulated like an immense collection of commodities, it occludes the structural conditions of the thinkable. Therefore, from the perspective of private opinions and their bleak experiential counterparts, that is, privatized Erlebnisse, economic poverty and the poverty of experience appear to be the fate of the individual. And of course, then people are sent to therapists and finding more meaningful experiences in life, and esoteric industry all starts here. And the whole coach industry starts here as well, coaching how you can find a meaningful existence in your maybe totally boring job. More than ever, the politico-economic deadlock of the faculty of imagination seeks its cure in the cult of individual creativity and compulsive production. Today we can see that it is exactly this kind of neurotic overproduction under the watchword of creativity that defines the paradigm of post-industrial immaterial labor and what Berardi calls semio-capitalism. In contrast, a materialist theory of capitalist poverty acknowledges and radicalizes the structural impoverishment of the realm of the thinkable by subtracting its ideological function, that is, undoing the pluralistic competition of privately owned standpoints on the marketplace of opinions, a place that Marx famously called the sphere of circulation, the realm in which, quote, freedom, equality, property, and Bentham prevail. The new barbarian is the unstable figure of the procedure of this impoverishment. His or her first task is to refrain from all attempts to creatively fill the modern lack of meaningful and traditionally embedded experiences with private ideas, standpoints, and opinions. Against the, quote, oppressive wealth of ideas that has been spread among people, or rather has been swamped them entirely, ideas that have come with the revival of astrology and the wisdom of yoga, Christian Science, chiromancy, vegetarianism and gnosis, scholasticism and spiritualism, the new barbarian affirms his or her experiential poverty in order to start from scratch, to make a new start. Third part, the destructive character. The figure who is ready to make a new start, for he has given up the complicating wealth of bourgeois humanism, is to be found in Benjamin's short piece, The Destructive Character. This is 1931, just 1 year after his radio talk on Brecht. In Fashion of the New Barbarian, The Destructive Character does the work of impoverishment, a work that designates a very peculiar form of destruction, oscillating between activity and passivity. Quote Benjamin, the destructive character is always blithely at work. It is nature that dictates his tempo, indirectly at least, for he must forestall her. Otherwise, she will take over the destruction herself. The agency of the destructive character is not derived from his or her own creativity, but from a heteronomous authority, nature. Radicalizing the already existing destruction of nature, the destructive character gives a dialectical twist to the decentering disempowerment of nature vis-a-vis human agency. The question, however, is, what is the destructive capacity of nature? What is the destructive capacity of nature? I suggest that we read nature here not only in opposition to civilization, as the ever-dictating cycles of organic emergence, but as society's second nature, zweite Natur, borrowing a central term from Georg Lukács's volume History and Class Consciousness. Benjamin was very familiar with Lukács's volume and held it in high esteem. 10 years after reading History and Class Consciousness, in the first version of the essay already mentioned, The Work of Art in Its Age of Technological Reproducibility, the term second nature will reappear in the context of his theory of emancipatory technology. If humanity does not learn how to master the forces of the most advanced technologies, the latter will appear to humanity as second nature in the same way as the primordial man faced first nature. In the concluding section of the essay, Benjamin speaks about an impending Sklavenaufstand der Technik, that is, a slave revolt of technology, which is about to happen if society fails to actualize technology's emancipatory potentialities. The result of this failure, as he prophetically warns, will be a hellish technology unbound, and eventually a diversion of its powers to the destructiveness of war and finally fascism. In light of Benjamin's reading of Lukács, it is second nature and the unmastered forces of modern capitalism that dictate the tempo of the destructive character. That is why I said it is oscillating between active agency and passivity, kind of reaction towards this tempo of the unmastered forces, technological forces of capitalism. If the destructive character is to forestall capitalism's creative destruction, to borrow a term from Joseph Schumpeter, he or she has to interrupt the accelerating cycles of capitalist accumulation. Put differently, he or she has to find a third way to cancel out the mutually presupposing extremes of capitalist creation and destruction. If the destructive character is not simply to take side with the former or the latter, he or she has to introduce an asymmetric negation to the opposition of creation and destruction, which is not simply stagnation or inertia. And also, it would also rule out something that Agamben famously claimed for his own theory, like kind of a figure like Bartleby, I refrain from doing. So let us look closer at the peculiar form of destruction that the figure of the destructive character enacts. And I quote a little bit from the piece on the destructive character, but I leave out other parts, so it's not exactly how it is written, but nevertheless, it's kind of a sample. So this destructive character knows only one watchword, make room, and only one activity, clearing away. His need for fresh air and open space is stronger than any hatred. The destructive character is young and cheerful, for destroying rejuvenates, because it clears away the traces of our own age. It cheers, because everything cleared away means, to the destroyer, a complete reduction, indeed a rooting out, out of his own condition. Really, only the insight into how radically the world is simplified when tested for its worthiness for destruction leads to such an Apollonian image of the destroyer. The destructive character sees no image hovering before him. He has few needs, and the least of them is to know what will replace what has been destroyed. The destructive character does his work. The only work he avoids is creative. Just as a creator seeks solitude, the destroyer must be constantly surrounded by people, witnesses to his efficacy. End of quote. Irving Wolfhard has rightly pointed out that the destructive character is not a psychological feature that could be attributed to an empirical person. I quote Wolfhard, "The destructive character is no character in the psychological sense. Character is rather one of his targets. What emerges from its effacement is the faceless model of a positively conceived characterlessness." End of quote. As the destructive character's efficacy is effacement, so his or her character is characterlessness. This change of perspective, conceiving of negative attributes not only as lack, but as a positive feature, alludes to a new form of positive or effective nihilism. The destructive character figures a defiguring activity, which cannot be mapped from the perspective of symmetric oppositions, such as positivity on the one hand and negativity on the other. As Wolfhard comments, quote, "Whereas romantic nihilism, wanton destruction for its own sake, represent a mirror image of productions for its own sake, and to that extent a harmless byproduct of the status quo, the effective nihilist enters," as he quotes Benjamin, "into his opponent's strength in order to destroy him from within." Although in this quote, Benjamin actually refers to Hegel's definition of what he calls eristic dialectics, it should be clear that the destructive dialectics of the destructive character follows a quite un-Hegelian program. His dialectics does not enact a Hegelian work of the negative, but stages a non-creative work of a nothingness, a nichts, which, quote, obliterates even the traces of destruction. I leave out a bit on the difference between nicht, negation, non, and the nichts, the nothingness, the nihil and Benjamin, but referring to you, Peter, this is actually the best part, I think, of Werner Hamacher's reading on Benjamin. It's all about the difference between nichten and vernichten. Vernichten, annihilate, also negate until nothing is left, and nichten, to make, basically, to put in action, to put forth a nichts, a non, a nihil. So, of course, you can make the pun in German, vernichten and nichten. So, basically, the passive activity, or active passivism of this figure, the destructive character, just leaving a trace of destruction, not in order to destroy, but for the space, is basically put a nihil, a nichts, into action. This is basically the idea. This is why I said asymmetric negation. It's neither negation nor the position, neither thesis nor antithesis, neither activity nor passivity. This is basically this kind of strange gray zone that in the other talk I called Dirty Dialectics of Benjamin. It's something in the dialectical movement itself, where Benjamin tries to place certain figures of defiguration that somehow bypass a vulgar understanding of Hegel. Of course, I know my Hegelian friends in Ljubljana will have a more sophisticated reading. They can also do this with Hegel. Yet I do it with Benjamin, nevertheless. So with regard to the destructiveness of capitalism as second nature, the destructive character's activity, or you can also say passivity, never rests and never enters into a state of synthesis or equilibrium. Paradoxically, his unstable work of destruction takes place in the same medium of capitalism's own mode of creative destruction. It marks the zero level of creative destruction, for it is only productive in a non-creative way. Again, you have a very strange conjuncture here. You have productivity, yet non-creative. Again, something we would normally say creative leads to production, non-creativeness is non-production, doesn't work for Benjamin. Here, destruction is not simply negative or bound to an economic chain of means and ends, but to a political activity. The political enactment of effective nihilism, however, designates a non-creative activity, as it is not emergent ex nihilo. Rather, it depends on others. And I quote Benjamin, just as the creator seeks solitude, the destroyer must be constantly surrounded by people, witnesses to his efficacy. End of quote. The destructivity of the destructive character is not self-sufficient, or means in its means in its as an end, but becomes only operative when performed publicly. In other words, the destructive character is a political figure. His actions cannot be defined essentially with reference to their inherent qualities, but only relationally to the public sphere in which they intervene and where they perform their clearing work. His dependency on the public makes him an inherently political figure beyond the scope of institutionalized parties or specific social groups. The destructive character can only do his work of destruction once he submits himself to the formal structure of the public, that is, the political and economic relations that form society. Only the ensemble of the relations of society provide the medium for destruction. The destruction at stake here is not teleologically aimed at a definite content, quote, what exists he reduces to rubble, not for the sake of the rubble, but for that of the way leading through it, end of quote. The immediate, that is, non-instrumental medium of destruction is nothing else than the way leading through the rubble, not for the sake of the rubble, but for the sake of the way itself. In this respect, the destructive character partakes in what the earlier Benjamin, the pre-Marxist Benjamin, would have called a politics of pure means. The destructive character's clearing activity is non-violent. Violent here, gewaltig, Gewalt, ist nicht gewaltförmig, ist non-violent, insofar as it is not instrumental and not self-sufficient, is not a means in an end in itself. Violence, if we recall Benjamin's earlier essay on the critique of violence, Kritik der Gewalt, is not defined in and by itself in a naturalist or essentialist way with regard to determinate actions, but in a purely relational manner. Quote, for a cause, however effective, becomes violent in the precise sense of the word only when it enters into moral relations, end of quote, which are defined in relation to the antithetical concepts of law and justice imposed by the state. Law imposed by the state, justice as something, Gerechtigkeit, which is irreducible to the state. So for Benjamin, law, Recht, on the one hand, and Gerechtigkeit on the other are irreconcilable. One is means and ends, chain of means and ends relations, and the other one is pure means. An action can only become violent once it is employed by a means and ends relation, such as the application of a law in order to achieve a certain result or behavior. Instead of following the basic dogma of bourgeois theories of violence, that is, quote Benjamin, just ends, can be attained by justified means used for just ends, Benjamin conceives of pure means. Pure means, however destructive they may be, are non-violent precisely because they have cut themselves loose from the means and ends relations imposed by the state, by the law, and so on. Only from the perspective of the non-hierarchical sphere of means, we can conceive of pure means, that is, non-instrumental, non-teleological, and to this extent, non-violent means, which no longer serve any higher ends or final goals. It's important to get the point in Benjamin that violence is not defined in itself. It's a relational concept. That means the same action can be violent or non-violent. You cannot define it according to the attributes in itself. You can only define it in relation to what he calls moral relations. So how it is put into action. So if I do a certain deed, something, an action, it can be non-violent or it can be violent, but only because of the configuration where it takes place. That is why Benjamin, by the way, is not a pacifist. That is why Benjamin not even has doesn't even condemn capital punishment. What he condemns is the justification, the ideological justification of capital punishment or of a war. The justification is you put an action into a chain of means and ends, as we had before in civilization. Just ends can be achieved by barbaric means and so on. This is for him violence, not the deed in itself. It's very important to have this in mind when thinking of the non-violent destructiveness of the destructive character and of his concept of barbarism. Otherwise, it doesn't make sense, because then you could say this deed, action, is violent in and by itself, and wherever you put it, it is violent. But this is exactly not what he's saying. It is the relation, the configuration where it takes place. So the destructive character shares this non-teleological feature with the figure of the new barbarian. They are pure means, interventions into the complicating chains of means and ends within bourgeois everyday life. Yeah? If you give me this, I give you that. If we can do this, instrumental reason, what Horkheimer, Adorno, a family is it called like this. These figures figure effective interruptions, radical simplifications without tarrying with their negative works of destruction. The destructive relief from the weariness of an endlessly complicated life, subjected to the spurious infinity of infinite tasks in order to meet the most basic needs in capitalism, has profoundly utopian qualities. Years later, in his preparatory notes to the thesis on the concept of history, he succinctly defines the, quote, function of political utopia as to cast light on the sector of that worthy of destruction. The utopian image of destruction is imageless. It only contains the emptied space, the tabula rasa that the work of destruction performs. The nichts, the nihil, the nothingness of Benjamin's effective nihilism does not stage a stable figure. Its traceless trace has no utopian form with which it could be aligned. In the same spirit, the destructive character sees no image hovering before him. As paradoxical as it might sound, the utopian surplus of Benjamin's non-utopian figures, such as the new barbarian or the destructive character, consists in their defiguring quality as both method and object of effective nihilism. To conclude, both the destructive character and the modern barbarian combine contradictory traits, which prove to be dysfunctional for political economic teleologies. They are political without having a message, effective without being creative, destructive without being negative or violent, figurative without representing an image. However, as pure interruption, they are working. If we are to find a new conceptual frame that could shed light on the nature of this peculiar work of destruction and simplification, a different concept of work might be instructive. In this sense, within the field of theory, Benjamin's figures of defiguration do the work of unworking, foreshadowing a concept which 50 years later the French philosopher Jean-Luc Nancy will introduce. Relying on Benjamin's friend and Parisian interlocutor Georges Bataille, in La Communauté des Oeuvres, was in 86 published, I think, the first time, Nancy described unworking as a withdrawal from work, as something that has no longer to do with either production or completion, but rather encounters interruption, fragmentation, suspension. In a way, you could say the unworked community is the political agency of Benjamin's effective nihilism. Benjamin has no own has never really theorized what a community could be, what is a linguistic community beyond functional socialization, but you find basically, or you can theorize this kind of community through the blank spots in Benjamin's own theory. This is, of course, lacking, but nevertheless, in the empty center of Benjamin's thought, there is something like an emergent, unworking new community. Sometimes he calls it the tradition of the oppressed, other times he says the fighting oppressed class, but there is no theory of community here. So nevertheless, we can basically supplement this a little bit with Nancy, if I may. So if we understand the work of the destructive character and the new barbarian as unworking, yet still working, as unworking, we can combine paradoxical features such as interruption and reliability, effectiveness and destruction, without forming a new stable image, a new synthesis. It's very important because Benjamin normally is read as pure interruption, as destitution, but no constitution. So someone like the flash of the famous flash of the dialectical image, light on, light switched off, and what's then? So of course there is both. There is reliability, there is continuity at the same time with eruption and interruption. So in a way, you can say these two normally as contradiction conceived features fit into the strange work of the unworking that are figured and defigured in these two figures, in the new barbarian and in the destructive character. So if theory has to impoverish itself in order to articulate the experience of the age of economic and existential poverty, the figurations of theory and their theoretical figures also need to defigure themselves. This movement of reduction has its materialist grounds in the actually existing nihilism of capitalist exploitation and its experiential counterpart, the poverty of experience. Radicalizing this imposed impoverishment, the figures of the barbarian and the destructive character unleash an asymmetric dialectics inside of the contradictory nature of the objects of criticism. Here it's capitalism. Thereby they accelerate the process of their object's decomposition by decelerating the creative destructive explosion of a technology that modern capitalism has generated without having developed the necessary technique to master it. If the average European, as Benjamin notes in his essay on Karl Kraus, has not succeeded in uniting his life with technology because he has clung to the ideology of creative existence, the figures of the barbarian and the destructive character are ready to face this challenge without giving up on technology's utopian space, the new Spielraum. If the function of the political utopia is to cast light on that worthy of destruction, only destructive figures are materially and ideologically impoverished enough to enter the new technological utopia, or rather atopia, a technological space beyond topical representation, a site which cannot be captured by ideals and stable images. As mentioned before, in the second version of the Work of Art essay, Benjamin introduced the concept of second technology, an emancipated technology which would open up a new Spielraum, field of action, beyond domination and instrumental means and ends relationships between nature and man. This liberating technology is not envisioned in humanist utopian manner, Rather, in ultra-modernist fashion, it radicalizes the experience of capitalist alienation and impoverishment in an atopian way. For Benjamin Hens, the technological medium of the post-humanist constellation of nature and humankind cannot be based on the idea of progress, improvement, and intensification of the productive forces of capitalism. The post-humanist harbingers of a new techno-anthropological life form are not anymore to be found in Nietzsche's Übermensch, the superhuman, or the Promethean new Soviet man, but in Benjamin's paradoxical figures of defiguration. The experiences of these atopian figures and their peculiar communist promise of reductive simplification and effective nihilism are yet to be told. Told to whom? With regard to Benjamin's anti-historicist theory of legibility, we are to ask, who is the untimely yet true reader of his figures of defiguration? What is the age that can recognize itself, that is, its own historical experience, in the unstable images of these impoverished figures? If the historical key to Benjamin's post-humanist figures does not solely lie in the 1930s, it is up to our age of capitalist realist impoverishment to re-evaluate the dangerous moment of modern barbarism once again. Thanks for your patience.